And what's going on, everybody? This is Terminator Juice, and this is going to be kind of a tech-related video. I've been getting a lot of questions over the last probably 6 months about the surround sound setups, and especially associated with the Wii U because of its lack of Dolby and DTS support. It only uses HDMI. Uncompressed audio in order to get true 5.1 surround sound. So that's left a lot of people out in the cold unless you have an HDMI capable receiver. So what this video is going to be, it's basically going to start with the basics of surround sound, some tips, setup tips, and then we're going to go through and actually show you guys setting up the receiver, a little more advanced techniques to get the most out of your sound. So let's start with the most basic of basic, and that's picking out a receiver. I always buy Onkyo brand, but you know, Sony, Yamaha, Denon, they all make good receivers, Harman Kardon. So pick out a receiver. My advice, in this day and age, it's hard to find a bad receiver, but my bottom line is always 100 watts per channel minimum. I like to get a little more than that if I can. So just pick out a receiver. Any modern receiver is going to have HDMI inputs, which will decode the audio. And so yeah, that's the first step. You got to get a receiver. Onkyo has some really good home theater in the box packages that comes with speakers and subwoofer, and you know, for a relatively decent price, between I think there's one for $300, one for $500, one for $700, depending on what you want. So so you get a receiver, and then obviously you need speakers to go with it. So those are the two first steps. I got Polk Audios. There's my center channel. I have a 5.1 system with a powered subwoofer. There's my left and right fronts. There's my right surround. And there's my left surround. So satellite speakers are very common, and they're popular in a living room setup because they don't take up as much space and they're not as big and gaudy for the wives and the girlfriends. They don't want to see speakers, but I think if you get some good satellite speakers, which are just small speakers without big woofers or anything, and then the subwoofer fills in the lack of bass that the satellites have. So get yourself some speakers. Polk Audio is what I always get, but they're a little bit towards the mid to high end. I did pick these up open box for $200 for the whole set, and back, you know, 5-6 years ago when they were $799 brand new. So I got a great deal on these, but get yourself any decent 5.1, just make sure it has a subwoofer, and the subwoofer has at least an 8 or 10 inch woofer with you know, above 100 watts. If you got a big living room, you'll need that. Don't get any little 6 inch woofer with 30-40 watts. It's just not going to cut it. So get that. Get everything, and it's going to be daunting to a beginner, because I have 19 years experience hooking up surround sound and going into the settings of the receiver. So to me it's second nature, but there are a lot of people who really know nothing about it. So that's kind of where the inspiration for this video came from, some questions I got recently. I realized there are a lot of people out there who don't even know the basics of home theater. So let's get started here. The first thing you're going to want to do, you get everything purchased, is you want to decide where you're going to put the receiver, because that's going to determine all your cord lengths, your speaker wire, all that. So get your receiver location picked out first. You have an entertainment stand. I like to put it in a centralized location, and the key thing is ventilation. See, I have at least 4 inches from the top of the receiver to the bottom of the cabinet. The front's wide open, the side's got close to an inch on either side, and the back, there's about 3-4 inches in the back for ventilation. That's a mistake a lot of people do, is they cram them into a tight spot with almost no room above for ventilation, and or they'll set their Blu-ray player or their cable box on top of it, and that's a big no-no. It's a risk of fire and reduce the life of your receiver by quite a bit. So, you know, mine's been on for a couple hours. It's warm to the touch, but it's not hot by any means. So get your receiver and get it set in the place you're going to have it. Then what you're going to want to do is hook up your speakers. So I have satellite speakers, and I decided to go with stands. It's a nice touch. A big no-no is to put the speakers either behind the receiver, behind the TV, or behind some picture frames and all that, because you're basically going to cut the sound in half if you got something in between you and the speaker. So a good solution is to buy these speaker stands. I got them at Walmart for like $30, and they're decent quality and flexibility for setup. So for the front speakers, I'm going to sit down here. Kind of the rule of thumb is you want the speaker, like the tweeters, to be as close to your ear level in your sitting position as possible as far as the height. So, you know, I'm sitting here, I'd say my speaker, the tweeters, are probably 6 inches below my ear level. That's a good range. You don't want them on the floor, you don't want them at the ceiling. So get within a foot up or down of your ear level is kind of a guideline. And I like to have them out a little bit, and then you turn them in. It's called towing them in, just slightly towards you. You don't want them pointing directly at you, but just slightly towards you, and that actually puts the sound field in the center, right in your listening position. So find a good spot for your fronts. Those are going to have a majority of the audio in most movies. But the most important one for movies is the center channel, because that gives you all your dialogue. Now, I broke the rule. Your center channel, you're supposed to have it near ear level as well, but that's very unlikely in most setups, because I got my TV stand here, it just won't fit. But there is a solution to get around that, and that is turn, let's say if you're like mine's below, then you have to prop up the front to get it angled. And what you want to try to achieve is have the angle of the face going up pretty much towards your ear level. If you drew a line off that, and if it goes up near your ear level, you're going to be okay. Same as if it's above, then you would prop up the back to get it pointing down. And actually, the way I have this set up right now, I can't even tell that the center channel is not at dead center of my TV. So that's a little technique to get around that. And you know, ideally you just have it at the same height as your fronts, but like you can see, that would make it in the right on my screen. So that's for the fronts. And then the surround sounds, and this one's very important. Trust me when I say I have 19 years of experience mounting speakers. Get them as close to the ceiling as you can and have them facing straight out. Ideally, you'd want them in line with your ear here, but because of my doorway where I'm standing right now, as you can see, I could have went above, but then I would have had some wires showing. So get as far or as close to your ear level, which would be about that between that clock right there. I had to make a sacrifice, but as long as you have it near the ceiling and you have a wall behind you, that'll make up the difference, because I can sit here, even though they're slightly in front of me, I still will hear things behind me, because movies use a technique to kind of diffuse the sound and deflect it and make it go kind of all over. So, you know, do the best you can, but the biggest factor is getting them up near the ceiling. That way the audio will bounce off the ceiling, off the back wall, and give you a true surround experience. There's a couple instances where you can test that out to hear how that sounds. And one is the theatrical trailer for the Texas Chainsaw remake with Jessica Biel. During that trailer, there's a scene where the screen goes dark and you hear somebody running to from the back to the front, and then you hear someone walking behind you. And even with these speakers in front of me, it still sounds like it's person's walking right behind me. So again, get them as close to the ceiling as you can, and trust me when I say that the results are the best I've experienced in my 19 years. I tried putting them ear level, I tried putting them behind me, and nothing comes close to having them up there. So basically, you get your speaker set, subwoofer, put it in a corner, and that takes a RCA cord instead of a speaker cord. So you get a single subwoofer cable, and there's a subwoofer out on the receiver, and just make sure it's in a corner, and you can move it around if you're not hearing any bass. There's levels you can adjust, but just move it around if you can. If you got flexibility, try it in another corner. Every room's different. There's no dead set way to do it. It's just put it in a corner and hope for the best. If you only have one option, then I guess that's all you got. But if you have multiple corners, try it and see what the results are. So, and one last thing before we move on to the actual receiver setup, I'm going to talk about speaker wire real quick. Two rules of thumb. And I have, they run up the stand here, but make sure your positive and negatives are hooked up. Red's positive, the wire has some kind of indicator on it usually. Just make sure the positive you plugged into the speaker is the same positive that gets hooked into the receiver. It doesn't matter if this wire had a white line, you can make it whatever you want, as long as the wire here on this end plugs into the black on the other end, and same with the red. If you mix them up, you lose quite a bit of your sound quality, and it's called being out of phase, and the sound will just kind of be dispersed, and it just won't have the right effect. So make sure you get the positive and negatives correct, and make sure you get a good thick speaker wire. A lot of the home theater in the box sets come with like 20, 22 gauge, like really thin wire. And a speaker wire gauge, the higher the number, the thinner the material. And with 16 gauge, this is RCA brand. It's got a good coating on it and a good thick wire. I would recommend 16 minimum, even with small satellite speakers. Do not use the thin stuff that comes with it. Just throw that stuff in the garbage and get yourself some decent speaker wire, because the difference is night and day. I've tested it myself. Very important. Highly recommend investing a little extra in some thicker speaker wire. It will pay for itself in sound quality, and has a lesser chance of interference with electrical and all, you know, all that. So get good thick speaker wire. Highly recommend that. And if you got to run some long runs like I did here to get that one mounted, it definitely pays off. So next I'm gonna kind of mount my camera on a tripod, and I'm going to show you some setup advice for the actual receiver, because there is quite a bit of options in there, so stay tuned for that. Alright, so once you get your receiver in place, you get your speakers set up, and wires run, next thing you want to do is hook your HDMI inputs from your devices into your receiver, and then you'll have an HDMI input going from your receiver to your TV. So basically, the receiver acts as a hub, and you could plug as many devices in as there are HDMI inputs in the receiver. So I have my cable box, I have my Wii U, and I have my Blu-ray player all hooked in. And then what? Basically, you leave your TV on the same input, and then you use the receiver to switch inputs, and that gets you, you know, to my HD TV. I even labeled the input. You can customize your labels. And so use your TV to turn on, and that's it. From everything else, runs through the receiver. Your volume control and your input control all runs through your receiver. So go back to Wii U. I have a Universal Harmony, Logitech Harmony remote, and I just hit, you know, play a game or play Wii U, and it switches everything to the appropriate input. But if you didn't, you would you could program your receiver remote to turn on your TV, and then everything else runs through the receiver, other than changing the channels on your Comcast or whatever box you have, Charter, You would still use that to change channels, but the receiver is your central hub. So some basic setup here. You get everything plugged in. You get speakers, everything hooked up. Turn on your TV, turn on the receiver. Then you have, this is my receiver's on-screen menu. Again, this is Onkyo. Go to the setup options and everything pops up on screen. So I would want to go to speaker setup first and speaker configuration. Might be called something slightly different. And in here, what you have is you're basically saying, yes, I have a subwoofer. If you don't, yes, it would be on no. There's also a place to set up and let it know that you have, let's say you had a 7.1 set up, there would be rear surround would be an option here, but since I don't have any, it's just a 5.1, I can set my front, center, and surround speakers. And what you're basically telling it here is you're basically the bass that speaker can handle. So I have very small satellite speakers, which you've seen. They're rated to go down to like 80 hertz or 70 hertz, whatever it was. There's no reason to have these small speakers trying to do bass. So what this means at 90 hertz and below, all the bass that would normally go to the front speakers is reallocated to the subwoofer. So I could set this, let's say I had some bigger speakers with a good woofer, they went down to 50 hertz. I might put it at 60 or 70, meaning all the sounds down to 60 hertz still to the front speaker. Anything below goes to the subwoofer. But again, since I have small satellite speakers with 3.5 inch woofer, there's no point in trying to have them do any kind of bass. So I actually have it above the standard. 80 is pretty much the standard, but I mean, I set this up 3 years ago. I did enough tests back and forth where I felt that this should be set the way it is for the best sound. And like I said, there's tiny speakers. There's no reason to have them try to do any kind of bass. That's what I got a 10-inch subwoofer for, powered subwoofer, handles all the bass. So that's what this setting is. Some receivers may still go by small, medium, and large. So small speakers or what I have would have had a preset range. Medium would have had preset, and then large, full range can handle any hertz. Like my tower speakers in my theater room can handle basically the full range. So that's what speaker configuration does. And refer to your speaker's specs. And let's say your speakers say they're rated down to 80 hertz. You could put it at 80, no problem. I like to go a little bit above what their bottom range is. That's just the way I've always done it, but you can do it anyway. The next thing you're going to do is set your speaker distance. A lot of people don't do this. I don't know how much of a difference it makes, but what you do is you sit in your sweet spot, your main seating position, and you, with the help of somebody, you get a tape measure, and you measure from the tweeter of that speaker to about your ear, and then you enter in that. This particular receiver is a lower end Onkyo. It only goes in 1 foot increments. My theater room Onkyo goes in 0.1 increments, so I can put 12.1, 12.2, basically get it down to the inch almost. And you know, I guess they felt with a lower end model it wasn't as necessary. And your center speaker is usually the closest thing to you. I would normally have that at 11.5, but I don't have the option. So I just have it at 11 because the way it's ideal, all speakers will be the equal distance from your ear. So you'd have to put them in an arch, kind of like the curved TVs. But, you know, I didn't have enough options. Depends on your receiver, how much of a increments you'll get. Most of them will be 1 foot increments. Some will be half foot at a time. And then the really high-end ones will have, you know, down to the inch. So yeah, you just set it forward, front, left, left and right, the center, then your surrounds, left and right, and your subwoofer. I have an ideal situation where I have a rectangular room and my seating position's in the center of the room, so my surrounds are the equal distance on either side. But let's say you had to sit closer to one wall, and one the right speaker would be 3 feet from you, and the left one be 10. This is where you would set that. It just helps the receiver know where your speakers are. And then the final thing would be your level calibration. And basically what this is, a way to balance it out. So 0 decibels for the front, left and right means whatever my volume, main volume is, that's the volume that my fronts will be. Now the center channel felt a little quiet to me, so I went up, went in, and I raised it 2 decibels above the fronts. So there would be no point in running the left and rights up to like 5 and then your center up to 7. It's still going to be a 2 decibel difference. So don't think that you're turning those up is going to make them louder. It's basically just the same as turning up the overall volume. So find out a good mix so you can hear the vocals, because your center channel takes basically all the dialogue from most movies and handles that. So you want to be able to hear what people are saying without having to turn up the rest of the movie so loud that the explosions are going to wake up the kids or whatever. So this is a way to adjust to make it so one particular speaker can be louder when you need it to be. And I always make the surrounds louder by default, even if they're close to you or closer to you than your fronts. Most movies don't have a lot of surround effects and they're not really loud, so it always helps to turn up the decibel on your surrounds. Here I went 5 decibels louder. In my theater room I went like 10 decibels louder, and then the subwoofer. And make sure you adjust these settings when you have the receiver at the volume you want, that you think will be like the loudest volume you'll watch a movie. Like mine's like 40 when I watch a movie, so that's what I would set these settings. I would turn up the receiver to 40 before doing this, so that I had, which I'll do right now. So now I have the receiver on full volume, or the volume that I would be max volume for me, and then you can hear. And then, once you set these, then play a movie, something you're familiar with different kinds of, like an action scene, so you can hear how the bass is going to sound. And if you feel like something's off, then go back in and calibrate it again, readjust. If you feel like the fronts are way louder, then you can even go into the negative. So if you wanted to. That's the main thing you want to set up. Those are probably the two most important things. Some receivers still have adjustments for treble and bass. This particular one doesn't. The only other thing I do is name edit, which is basically just giving the input an actual specific name. Like I named this one Wii U, and I named my movie Blu-ray one Blu-ray, and then the cable box. Obviously, just put HD. I just put HDTV for the name. So there's all kinds of things you can see. Listening mode presets. You can have volume setup. When you turn on the receiver, you can set it to the volume you want it to turn on at, and a max volume. I always have my power on volume at 35. The max loudest I've ever had this receiver was 45, so I'm going to put the max volume at 50, just in case someone sits on the remote and doesn't know it, turns it up way too loud. This will block that from blowing your speakers and stuff. So it's a really cool feature. I definitely recommend. The power on volume is nice because you don't have to turn it on and then look to set the volume higher immediately. It just turns on to the ideal setting for me, which is my average of 35 while watching most things. That's plenty loud, and if I want to go a little bit louder, I can. So basically that's how you do it. You can tune a lot of other things, but a lot of it's kind of technical and unnecessary unless you have a really advanced setup. But any other questions or any other setup things, it depends on the model, the brand. So just go to your owner's manual and look it over, and hopefully you get a book in yours. This last one I bought had a digital one on a disc, and it was just kind of confusing to find what I was looking for. If you get a book one, a paper one, it's really nice to have it in your lap. And just flip through it. And it, give yourself a couple days, listen to it, tweak some of your settings back and forth, you know, your levels, until you're happy. The bass, your receiver, or your subwoofer, usually has a volume knob. So there's a lot of stuff to dial in, put on your favorite music, something that you're familiar with, maybe the bass level or the treble level, and set it to that, and you know, get a kind of a baseline. So hopefully this wasn't too confusing or too technical, and hopefully it helps somebody. So that's gonna be it for this video. And like I said, it was kind of a basic thing. Anyone that's set up stuff in the past, probably not going to get much out of this, but this for beginners. Hopefully this helped you, and we'll see you next time. Thanks for watching.